Good evening. I'm Jonathan Fanton, the interim director of Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to a very special evening, and my obligation to ask you to turn off your cell phones, please, and check to be sure. Many of you have been here before, and I see others of you who are here for the first time, which is a great pleasure. So you know we do book discussions like Ira Katznelson's Fear Itself. We have world leaders like the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court, Luis Moreno Ocampo. We talk presidential politics like our last conference on Eisenhower Reconsidered. We do all those things, but tonight is different. I've long wanted to have a series of conversations with the most interesting people that I know personally. Ed Koch was my first guest, followed by MoMA President Agnes Gund, then Vartan Gregorian of the Carnegie Foundation, Jim Lipton of Inside the Actor Studio, and more recently, civic leader and board member Rita Hauser, who's here with us tonight. Tonight is doubly special for me because our guest is John Seely Brown, who's been my mentor both at the New School and at the MacArthur Foundation, where he was a trustee for a decade. JSB, as he's known to most people, is a modest man, a generous man, a man who cares, listens deeply, and tries to help. And he does help. Every person and institution is different and better after an encounter with John Seely Brown. He did his undergraduate work at, guess where, Brown University, and then earned a PhD from the University of Michigan in computer and communication science. He had a long career at Xerox, serving as its chief scientist and director of Xerox PARC Research Center, and that was when Xerox PARC really was the place to be, the center of innovation and discovery. He did a lot there, and he'll tell us about that, I hope, when we talk. JSB is a scholar in his own right, having published over 100 papers in scientific journals and authored must-read books like The Social Life of Information, The Only Sustainable Edge, The Power of Pull, my favorite book, Design Unbound, and The New Culture of Learning. He's lectured widely all around the world and is currently a visiting scholar at the University of Southern California. In addition to MacArthur, he served on the boards of Brown University, now on the Amazon and Corning boards, and he's in demand as an advisor to governments around the world, from Singapore to Spain. At the New School, JSB served on the President's Technology Advisory Committee, and he really helped us put the word new back into the New School as we became a pioneer over 20 years ago in distance learning, one of the first universities to offer a degree, an undergraduate degree wholly online. And he saved Parsons School of Design, which had been slow to adapt to new technology, by persuading us to start an interdisciplinary, what he called a knowledge union, with state-of-the-art equipment and technology. He was one of the first new trustees I recruited when I went to MacArthur, and he made a difference there as well. And here's what I said on the occasion of his retirement, and I quote, JSB, the most interesting work of our generation at MacArthur flows from your partnership with our staff. You transform the way we think, view the world, do our work. Our language changed as we spoke of emotional listening, complex adaptive systems, the power of pull, going to the edge, pushing beyond our comfort zone, crafting new learning environments, and 21st century skills. So a lot of different challenging thoughts in that string of words. And it was John who proposed that we create a fund for new ideas to encourage people to put forward fresh, risky ideas of their own. And any of us in this room who have ever had to deal with a foundation, apologies, Will Miller, and been told by a self-satisfied foundation officer that our idea, our proposal is out of program, will know how important it is to have a foundation with a fund where your ideas matter. And it was John who had the idea for a New Ideas Fund, chaired our trustee committee that made the decisions, and good things flowed, like a new field called neuroscience and the law, or new projects like E.O. Wilson's Encyclopedia of Life were all supported by our new fund, thanks to John. So I'm looking forward to this conversation. He and I will talk for about 50 minutes. We'll open it up to your conversation and questions, and then I promise you'll be out no later than 7, probably a little before. So John, if you'll join me.
I'm kind of speechless, so why don't you just carry on?
Well, I said this was a doubly special evening, and it is. You've written a great deal, as we've just discussed. You're in high demand as a speaker around the world, but we don't know, at least most of us don't, much about your early life. Could you tell us about your parents, your family, some early influences, good and bad, that help us understand where this giant and genius came from?
Well, I'm afraid, Jonathan, you'll find that story not that interesting, but surprising. I was very fortunate. My grandfather was a professor of mathematics at Helmholtz College, and my father was a professor of physical chemistry, and my mother, head of the fine arts library. What this really meant is I didn't have to go to school. I could just hang out in my father's library, my mother's library, my father's laboratories, right, spent most of my life, and could actually work with students at a very, very early age and just understand the essence of kind of legitimate peripheral participation. I was legitimate because I was his son, and I could participate as much as I wanted. And I learned almost everything by just hanging out and asking questions, pushing things, and so on and so forth. So I was kind of a master tinkerer. And much to the surprise of many people, I was a horrible, horrible student. And in fact, I credit my parents because I kind of invented my own language to speak in, partially mathematics, partially English. And it didn't work out too well for the first 4 years in school. And my parents were called in to say they doubted if I would ever graduate from sixth grade. My father said, well, why don't we give it a chance? I was off and saying, no, I'm out. He said, oh, no, you got to go to school. I said, I don't know why, but... But so it was a really sobering thing to me to see that we all have different developmental rhythms, especially guys, and that I was very, very late at playing the official game. So I tried to catch up.
Well, you had a really interesting set of early job experiences, and I think we'd be interested and how those jobs influenced you and helped you look at the world more socially. If I recall, you hold a distinction one summer of being the youngest licensed bookie in the state of New York.
So that is true.
Is that true?
Yes, but it is true.
Tell us a couple stories that help us understand pre-Xerox how you...
So let me start first with a little bit of context. My mother was clearly in the arts and the literature, and as a very, very young kid, I just couldn't understand why I should read. I kept saying to her, can't you just frame it as a theorem? And I'll get it, you know? And she looked very discouraged. So it turned out I was moderately, if not very good in mathematics and in numbers. So that's how I got to be this bookie. And it was a very exciting job. That's the way I was going to put myself through college, Brown University. I was 18 at the time. And my first major learning event happened is because, yeah, I could calculate a blinding speed, actually, in those days. I can't now. And it turns out that, as you know, on the racetracks, you got to kind of close the bets out before the race starts, obviously. I, as the bookie, gets to place the last bet. This is a bigger story. But what turned out is I quickly learned that being great at math and didn't really count as much as being able to read context, because I was always being cheated. And the catch was to figure out who was going to cheat me the most, because I didn't really have full time to be able to count all the money. And so I had different counting heuristics depending on how trustworthy I thought the person actually was. Like, I could check parity and so on and so forth to see if it was an honest mistake and only be off by one. I had more complex techniques than that, et cetera, et cetera. And so I suddenly started to realize that being great in math was okay, but being able to read context was more important than ever. And then you also start reading context not only in front of you in terms of making the book, but you suddenly start paying more context to what numbers are being skewed, what conversations are going on amongst the horse traders themselves. And you begin to read all kinds of things about what are some of the things that are happening behind the scenes as well as happening in front of you. And, you know, I was an 18-year-old kid, and I was saying, like, wow, this is kind of surprising. And it was kind of my first major movement, thinking, like, it was okay to be a hardcore geek, but sometimes it might help to complement that with being able to look at the surrounding context a little bit more.
And that's a key insight, which we'll hear again and again this evening. But you did some other things, don't we?
Yeah, I did a bunch of things.
Don't we have you to thank for elevators that are very efficient?
Yeah, this actually came up today in a different way. I also programmed the high-rise elevators. The question was, how do you do an optimal scheduling of this? And I had the fortune of being given a 790 computer to be able to use on my own at nighttime to do this optimization routine. I did it for the building, it was a Union Carbide building in those days. It was on 48th Street and Park Avenue. I think it's 48th Street. It's a big building and many, many elevator banks and dot, dot, dot. So, all right, you know, I can crack this problem. I wrote out the optimization equations, dot, 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 and grabbed the computers. I worked for about, 3 weeks on optimizing this very complex set of equations. I was so proud, and I went and I installed the new routines into the elevators. About an hour later, I get this infuriating phone call. I'm like, Brown, what have you done? And I said, what do you mean what I've done? This is fantastic optimization. And they said, well, first of all, do you realize that on floor 48 is where the CEO, and you didn't actually optimize, i.e. take over the entire bank to get him to that 48th floor. And I said, well, of course not. You wanted to optimize the total flow through the building, didn't you? And they looked at me and said, you don't get it, do you? And then, two or three more times I got calls saying, like, what about this floor? And I suddenly realized that optimization was a story for a corporate hierarchy. And you optimize it relative to an implicit schedule that nobody was willing quite to tell you about. So that was number one. And the second reason I got into a lot of trouble is I wanted to build my own statistics. And so I for days on end, measured everybody coming in, what time they came in, dot, dot, dot. And then one day I decided to integrate this curve. And I integrated this curve and I said, this is really weird. Only half the people are coming to work. So I was so proud, I ran up to the, I said, like, look at this amazing finding. I said, could you forget that finding? Again, it was kind of this sense of being this hardcore geek, turned out actually to have very little to do with actually being effective. So it was kind of the beginning of a long career of saying, like, math is great, physics is great, but it's augmented by a few more things.
John Seely Brown is a very distinctive name, and two elements of it were part of my childhood. I grew up in Connecticut, and there was a congressman named Horace Seely Brown. And are you related to him? And tell us a little bit about your own political development. Who were some of your heroes and heroines growing up.
So it's not too surprising. Horace Seeley Brown was my uncle, my only uncle. And he was also had a fantastic apple orchard, is probably how you knew him, in Pomfret, Connecticut. I lived in upstate New York, Hamilton, New York. My family was a slightly different, I was a different political orientation than he was. He was a hardcore Republican. And it was sobering again to me because I loved working on in the apple orchard, and that was real physical work. It was kind of new to me because I tinkered with amplifiers and not driving tractors. But what I learned from him is, some of you may know him, although he's now, you know, obviously dead. Not obviously, but he is dead. he was a very famous politician because he used to do door-to-door campaigning, handing out hot pads with a vote for Seeley Brown on the hot, is that what you call it, a hot pad? You pick up an iron and you pick up a hot pad? I don't work much in kitchens.
You have to give him a tutorial, Susan.
Yeah, clearly. You try, help us. And so I was astounded. I sometimes travel with him, and he kind of loved talking to people. And he was married a fairly, you know, wealthy wife, so they lived in a big estate in Pomfret, Connecticut. And I was always struck that we might have a formal dinner, and it sometimes would be a knock at the door, and it would be a farmer in his congressional district, District 2. And almost without fail, he would always be invited in and always be placed at the head of the table next to my uncle. And my uncle would spend all the time talking to him. And I suddenly realized that this kind of grassroots politics really was real there, and how much we've left it now. And it was kind of sad to see the comparison between the way he actually dealt with his constituents and what we now see today.
So I think we can see in that story something about you, which is that you respect all people, and people feel that no matter what station in life, how well educated, you listen and you learn and you respect. You've written about serendipity and the importance of serendipity. What are some of the serendipitous encounters that you've had that that changed the course of your life?
Oh, jeepers. First of all, I have a very bad memory. so I think, you know, in many ways, one of them was, and you don't know this one. I'm also a motorcycle fanatic.
That one. Tell that story.
Well, you don't know this one, I don't think, but I drive a BMW. I did. I've kind of more or less given it up now, but only very recently. I love BMW motorcycles. And I was out in Colorado someplace, and lo and behold, I got pulled over by this state cop. He was on a motorcycle. You know, and I was doing not anything particularly outrageous. He stopped, and he came up to me, and I said, like, officer, I don't get it. I'm being pretty reasonable. And he said, I want to talk to you. And I said, okay. And he said, like, I want to hear about your motorcycle. I'm driving a Harley-Davidson, and I want to hear about it. Is a BMW really that much better than my bike? And I said, officer, I hate to tell you, but yes. And then we had, you know, an hour conversation. I think I even offered to let him take the bike for a ride. But again, it was just kind of like saying these things kind of happen. And if you kind of just sit back and play with it, it turns out to be some pretty amazing things happen. And so that wasn't the thing you had in mind. Did you have anything particularly?
No.
Okay.
No.
I'm sure that wasn't what you had in
mind.
No,
but I was leading up to, how did you get to Xerox? How did that begin?
Well, I was at Bud Brannick and Newman, a little company inside Cambridge, where we did actually packet communication, which was actually the beginning of the ARPANET, the internet. Not Al Gore's version, but our version. Actually, Al Gore had a fair amount to do with some of this, by the way. And then kind of what happened is I didn't like cold. So when it got to be wintery, I would get invited to come out and spend a couple of months at Park in Palo Alto, which is kind of a cool place to be in the wintertime in Cambridge. So I started hanging out there. And then after about the second winter, they said, well, you know, why don't you come out here more permanently? And that's kind of how I made the major move out there.
And you were head of Xerox PARC, I think, for 15 years. What discoveries there are you proudest of? And tell us how you helped move Xerox from a user-centered focus to thinking about how groups work. And did Xerox make good use of the inventions flowing from its research facility?
Well, that's a long story, and I have Roger Levy here as the chief strategy officer of Xerox at the same time. Most people probably do know that Xerox PARC kind of invented what you think of as the modern-day computer in terms of bitmaps, windows, mice. We actually stole the mouse, but we made it actually work.
What year is this?
71, 72. 70s? Early 70s. And in fact, I had never seen the famous computer called the Elto, which is a personal computer that Xerox PARC had invented, which was this beautiful graphic machine that had the mouse and all this kind of thing. And I remember walking into the room when I saw that. I watched Alan Kay, the famous Alan Kay, do a few things on it, including playing some music. And I turned around and I said, oh my God, this is a new world. I want to be here. And that was that actually pushed me over the edge to say, okay, you know, I'll come. But PARC is usually noted for kind of the graphical user interface, which defines Apple, et cetera. So we really perfected personal interaction with the machine. But that's only step one. Step two is how do groups of people actually work? How do organizations actually work? How do you start to understand that it's not just user-centric, but group-centric, collective-centric, and so on and so forth? And then that got us much more into, you know, looking at more than just the individual, into kind of like, how does this technology get accepted in the workplace? How do people help each other? How do you do peer-based learning? It turns out no matter how well a machine is designed, actually, you almost never pick it up on your own. You pick it up with somebody else. In today's age, if you have a 12-year-old kid, you can pick up anything. Okay. In those days, you didn't have 12-year-old kids working in the workplace. So you have to really figure out ways to kind of turn the workplace into a miniature learning environment. And so we spent a lot of time looking at, how do you kind of create a new social space where peer-based learning is critical, and the willingness to mess up all the time and ask for help became totally legitimate. And in fact, I had a brilliant secretary or assistant who was terrified to make a mistake. And she was incapable of learning how to use the system. Until I finally just pointed out to her, say, you see this person over here? You want to see the four mistakes they just made? why don't you go over and start talking to her? And you start to kind of realize that we all learn by making errors and by learning from those and so on and so forth. So that was kind of the beginning of how do you really make this kind of much more of a kind of a social experience in the workplace. And then how do you build social technologies that actually facilitate this? So we were probably the first ones to really invent ways to use social networks. This is in the mid-80s. They weren't called social networks yet. That hooked together 25,000 of our tech reps around the world to look at how they could learn from each other. So in those days, we had these famous tech manuals because our equipment was pretty complicated to fix, to work. I mean, these are huge machines, if you remember, Roger. And it turned out that the tech reps never wanted to carry these manuals into the workplace. And, you know, they were well-written manuals, more or less, as manuals go. And so, you know, we simply started to ask, why don't you want them? And we, this is where we started bringing anthropologists into play here, because we really wanted to know what was really going on. And lo and behold, what we quickly discovered is that the tech rep said, look, I look like a fool walking in to fix this machine, carrying this manual. And my success in fixing this machine is actually to figure out much more about how that machine was being used. So I had to build a reputation with the people running the machine, responsible for the machine, okay? So you just gave us an artifact that destroyed my reputation. So you engineers think you're so goddamn clever, okay? But you've destroyed the way that I actually need to pick up the important information in that environment. And that was kind of the beginning. And then it turned out that we realized that how these guys really did deep troubleshooting for machines that were kind of really problematic is a bizarre way that they would actually call in a buddy at the time, another service tech rep. And in my terminology, somewhat colorfully, they would start a little bit of a war dance around the machine, telling each other stories, making a measurement, saying, well, you know, I remember something else that had this property to it, and this suggests this, and then the next guy would say, yes, yes, and then I make this measurement. So each measurement led to furthering the story. And so when they actually built a story that explained all the symptoms of the machine, basically the machine was fixed. Okay, so basically troubleshooting became storytelling. But what then became interesting is because there was storytelling, the stories were really often very good. And so they ended up swapping stories with each other. And the real learning happened by swapping stories. And so we said we can capitalize on this fact. We built this social network scheme where anybody could publish their story, assuming they got five other tech reps to be actually able to warrant the story. But to warrant the story, they had to go over the story and sign their names as well as the person whose story it was. That started kind of creating a way to look at the kind of interesting cycle between social capital, reputational capital, and intellectual capital. And we started to interleave these three things together. And then amazing things started dropping out from this very simple idea of just saying, look at the social space that's happening around this machine, and how do you actually build now not just something that collects, but refines knowledge? Because telling each other these stories was actually a knowledge refinement as well as a knowledge collection.
In your book, Design Unbound, do you introduce some interesting concepts like strategic ambiguity and structured indecisiveness? I like that one. As a key to the pathway to a complex unity, in your words. Talk to us about the shift from the industrial age to the information age, again, in your words, from clocks to clouds, from mechanistic models to ecosystemic models.
So I maybe reframe the question a little bit from the industrial age in the first phase of the information age, which is still relatively machine-like. So what characterizes our world today is we are all incredibly densely interconnected to everything happening around the world. And so the density of connections has gone radically up. We're now affected by all kinds of things all over the world in ways we never were before. And so I think a better way to look at today's world is to think of it as much more of a ecosystem in its own right, where you don't have individual components that you can take apart and kind of improve, but rather everything is interconnected with everything else, kind of like wicked problems, which most of the problems are we have today. So as soon as you start to kind of attack one problem, that problem starts to shift. And so you have to think about this thing as kind of an emergent system. And I think that we have to kind of now build a new set of metaphors, because engineers, we're very good at attacking fixed problems. We're not very good at attacking something as soon as we attack it, the problem changes. So take something even like cancer. You know, we think of cancer as a noun. Well, maybe cancering is a better way to look at it. How do we put probes? How do we put modulators into the system to be able to look at something that every time you touch it, just to transform, mutate itself, and so on and so forth? Now, certain cancers are not that way, but some of the nastiest cancers are. And so we're kind of suggesting that an awful lot of the wicked problems have this interesting property. As soon as you touch it, it starts to change. So you start looking at how do you kind of manage these problems, not solve them. And then how do you actually understand the context that these problems are embedded in? How do you work with those contexts? That's just the beginning of a long story, but very briefly, not just kind of working from clocks where you can take them apart and fix them and rebuild them. Tinkering is very simple. To clouds, not cloud computing, but clouds as emergent structures that are constantly being radically impacted by contextual changes around them. And so even going back to the early Xerox stories, it's kind of like saying, maybe we spent too much time on things and not enough time on context. So, or my bookie story was kind of about how do you start to read context? Maybe much more information is in the context that meets the eyes. So if you actually move to more an Asian point of view, you start thinking about what are the propensities? And can you actually shape contexts to actually change propensities? So it starts to change the vocabulary a little bit as well. And so it gives you quite a different lever, you know, lever on a lot of classical problems. Let me take a very simple case, because in this country, because we do some of the stuff in Washington, and we know a lot about statecraft, which is very much of a top-down system. We know almost nothing about streetcraft, which is the mechanisms on the ground. And then how do things that are happening as organic systems on the ground start to interact up here and vice versa? And so you begin to say, no, we got to pay much more attention to how our context unfolding, what are the probes in the context, how do we read the context, how can the context be nudged? So we shift the propensities. So these are things that engineers don't typically think about, but it really brings social science and humanities back in the game in, I think, some very powerful ways.
As we're living in this new and changing age, we look around and we see some companies that we've known forever, like IBM, doing pretty well. We see others like Kodak virtually out of business. And you've said that the whole purpose of the firm is changing. There's a new paradigm, which to accelerate talent development or capability development, not minimize transaction costs. One's competitive edge in the future will come from being able to build deeply innovative new pools of talent faster than anyone else. And you cite Google as an example. So looking over the kind of American business scene, what companies, Google, what others have done particularly well in this new and challenging time, and what ones really break your heart, shouldn't have gone down the tube, but are?
Let me reframe it a little bit. We've been arguing that we're living in a world now, and I won't bore you with this, but driven continuously by exponential forces, digital forces, et cetera, that are not going to terminate for decades to come. Yes, Moore's law is going to run out of power, but we know how to fix that in multiple ways. It's our guess that the average half-life of a skill today has moved down to 5 years. So we've gone from an era of 25 to 30 years to 5 years or less. If that's the case, you don't expect to go back to school to pick up the new skills. In fact, it's going to be the workplace where we're going to do most of our learning. And so the whole catch is what is it in the workplace that accelerates the ability to learn, to build new skills, to cultivate new dispositions, and how might that be accelerated? We don't usually think about the workplace being designed to accelerate learning. We think about it as designed to be scalably efficient. So simply asking, if the move today is a world of moving from a world of push, where we would figure out exactly how to get scalable efficiency to work as best as possible, to a world of pull, where I'm constantly pulling things off the internet, for example, to help me when I get stuck, and then engage in peer-based learning to figure out what to do. Now the catch is maybe the strategic leverage you have is scalable learning, not scalable efficiency. In fact, I could argue that exactly the thing that made companies so successful in the 20th century will kill us in the 21st century. Scalable efficiency does not lead to scalable learning. We can argue that, and I can actually dissect Cummings this way. So I think that that is what we were really after. Now, what actually makes the firm capable of having us pick up new skills? Well, again, it's going to be learning on demand, pull-based learning, peer-based learning, interest-driven learning, and the freedom to try things out. And so in some ways, you have to have agency. So you got to kind of restore a sense of just not blind execution, but the ability to have some sense of I can try this stuff out. And yes, I can make mistakes, but I can learn from those mistakes. And by the way, one of the best ways to learn from mistakes is to learn from peers around you, So, I mean, I think you begin to get quite a different shift. Now, I became much more aware of this when I started to interview kids going to Google. And what I suddenly started discovering is that they were not going there because of salary. Salary was not necessarily that great at Google. By the way, it was 8 years ago because you got stock options when it mattered. But, but you know, today that's not so true. And, you know, the pay is not particularly great. Same with Facebook, by the way. And so why do you go there? Well, the answer was not necessarily pretty. The answer was we want to pick up skills that we couldn't learn in universities because the universities hadn't caught up with the modern age. So take big data. Take graphic processing units. Take cloud computing. Take cloud computing 5 years ago now, okay? These are all at the cutting edge of almost every new startup that I deal with. And most universities are barely teaching courses in them now. Because basically this stuff is quite different from the skills we learn in client-server architectures, von Neumann architectures, and so on and so forth. Now we can argue that, but the point is that they were coming out here to actually marinate in the ultra-high tech world and to get kind of gut feelings for how to work in this space. And that's what was going on. And I think that it was kind of very sobering to me. You know, I am fond of saying, you know, what I talk about is 10 to the third. Roger will know that, you know, at Xerox PARC, we would try to take on problems that if we couldn't do 10 times better than the existing system, don't do it. Because the time you got it into the core of the corporation after they mutated it through their immune system, or we garbled it in some incoherent way of talking, which is probably the case, you know, the time would have gone. But 10 to the third is now a better way to be thinking of things, something to do with the pace of change. But most of us can't even begin to think what 10 to the third means. I mean, think about it in two simple little ways here. Most of us can understand, you know, 100 books. Probably nobody here could actually, except maybe you, Jonathan, could master 100,000 books. You know, that's just qualitatively different. I don't mean read it, I mean master them, okay? You know, many of us in this room, not many, but some of us in this room have no trouble working pretty effectively with 100 computers. To work with 100,000 computers, you really have to think differently. And these are the kinds of changes we're now experiencing, and you want to kind of, you know, if you're a 20-year-old kid, you want to kind of be in those places that you can have those experiences.
Let's go back to the implication of what you just said for universities. You've been on the board of Brown. We're at Hunter. I've been president of the new school. Well, listen, an anecdote or two of something that surprised you?
I mean,
coming to know the CIA as well as you now do.
Yeah. I think I may know where you're heading.
No,
you want to know about somebody over there? But the
you know, you must know people from Hawaii.
Yeah.
Even if they're in Moscow now.
Right, I knew it. The idea is in asymmetric warfare, which is what we're in. Consumer electronics is where the real innovations are. If you can figure out how to hack consumer electronics and computation, you can do a lot of stuff. And also to be able to track this stuff, you need to be able to understand what stuff can be done, and you need to use some of our best technology to be able to make sense of what's going on. The intelligence community has massive classical computers and massive classical ways to look at things, and they have their frames to make sense out of things. Many of those frames haven't changed that much in a long time. And so the catch was, could we actually build something on the edge of the intelligence community that lets them tap the best thinking going on in the venture world, you know, often coming from Silicon Valley, but elsewhere as well. And could we actually go out and find those places and see if they might like to take on a problem to show how their equipment could be used inside the intelligence community. We had a safe house, so to speak, that you could try this stuff out without having to go through super and clearance mechanisms yourself. A lot of these ventures, are really happy to be able to have new, real, big problems to work on. And one of the things you don't have to worry is about your competitors finding out about it, because this is one place you don't worry about anybody finding out about anything. So it turned out to be kind of a total win-win situation that brought much more modern thinking, cutting-edge thinking, into the agency, but also helped propel some of the best products we all use today on the internet as well.
And have you learned anything that you didn't know from the Snowden disclosures?
We're very good at collection. I've always been interested in hackers. And in fact, you may not know, but I ran a 3-day Socrates seminar last week, at Aspen. And the first day was on how to hack in education. The second day was how to hack the workplace. And the third day was kind of how to hack a factory system. Now, hacking to me is a good thing. It's kind of how do you kind of make unusual things happen with what you have out there and so on and so forth. But I find a way that, hackers work in terms of the bad stuff also very interesting. And we don't take very seriously building safe networks. That was not why we built the internet. We built it for maximal flexibility to try ideas out. The kinds of issues we're now facing we never dreamed about. So the fluidity of the internet was to facilitate experiments was brought us where we are today. If we knew about today, you might design the internet differently. It's kind of hard to go back and redesign it, but there's a lot of interesting thinking about how that might be actually doable.
You think young people these days are growing up with a different sense of privacy, what privacy is? A lot of the outrage we see at the intelligence agency surveillance comes more from older people than it does from younger people, so to say. Yeah.
Let me frame it slightly differently. there is, I think, a fundamental shift happening, I'm going to call it, with the millennials. And many of us in this room, starting with myself, grew up with a sense of identity. Personal identity was often what I owned, what I wore, what I controlled. And the more I owned, the more sense, the bigger my identity was. Yeah, it's a shorthand. Today's millennials are far, far from that. I would say as a simple characterization of today's millennials is I am what I create, number one, what I share, call that remix, number two, but most importantly, three, what others build on what I have shared, okay? So it's not just what I have given to other people from what I've done, but have I helped them build on it. Now, for some of us in this room, if you came out of the open source community, they say, there, and they're right, there. But in fact, this is a broad-based spirit, and it's a spirit of reinstituting agency. And so the sense of to build, share, and help others build on, and have my identity go with that. Creative Commons helps that in terms of licensing procedures, et cetera, et cetera. It's a very interesting world. And I think that we have a hard time understanding kids that are operating this way because they worship agency. And one of the things I find tricky is most corporations do not understand the power of agency, do not understand the power of letting kids actually try things, building things, and sharing them. And so I think that we're actually moving into a very optimistic world where kind of intellectual capital, social capital, reputational capital are kind of coming together, and we're displacing a single focus on financial capital to financial, social, and intellectual capital, all kind of in an equilateral triangle. If that turns out to be true, and we have the tools to be able to amplify that, as I think we really do, I think the networked age around the globe, I mean, it's interesting, I do some work in Detroit, in the bombed out parts of Detroit, in terms of the maker movements and what these kids are doing. You know, one group we're looking at there is learning from kids in Kenya. And so we now have kind of very interesting, almost networks of intimacy, cells working across the world, how they're learning from each other. We actually have a lot to learn from Africa, and they have a lot to learn from us. I see some signs that don't penetrate into the thinking of our school system. They don't penetrate into the thinking of our university system, but they may be forming kind of the very social fabric and meaning fabric of these millennials. In that sense, that's pretty damn exciting.
One more question, then we'll open it up. Picking up on this, the defendable optimism that you've been expressing, does that carry over into the political realm? I mean, a lot of us kind of moan about how bitter the partisan divide is, how hard it is to get things done, how screwed up our country is. Do you have some hope that technology, social media, the kind of trends you've been talking about, the young people, the way they look at the world differently, is that going to carry over into the political sphere?
Well, I have, tremendous optimism. Let me give you just two kinds of stories, one quite different. One is this strange place called New York. If you actually look at the kinds of things that are happening in terms of big data and bringing citizens in, and the thing that's happening with Bob Steele and Michael Bloomberg in creating a complete new kind of innovation, happening here that will be almost more cutting edge than Silicon Valley in 5 to 10 years. And it has a different spirit to it. And I think that the Cornell Israel setup is just another example of this. I think this is tremendously exciting. I think also what we're going to find, this will lead into my second story, but the role of the arts are going to become increasingly important, the humanities and the arts, because in fact, if this change is happening as fast as I'm saying it is, the real catch is how do you reframe your understanding of the world? Well, one way to view art is art helps you see things differently. And that willingness to kind of see things differently, you get somewhat out of the humanities, you get it a lot out of the arts, and so I think we're going to find that skill more important than ever. So let me end with one favorite story we open up this book, Design Unbound, on, is El Sistema in Venezuela into the favelas. And it was a brilliant move to create originally a 12-person youth orchestra in the worst parts of the of the ghetto down there. And then understand how to do this, because classical music, how a sense of belonging started to develop with these kids, how the rhythm of music actually transcended their own understanding of music, but a sense of union, a sense of the whole being more than the sum of the parts. And then to watch how this started to spin out, to go from the families to the whole villages, from the villages then to the country, in terms of a major youth orchestra movements that understood in kind of an emergent system how you have to kind of take everything as situated, not as just the best practices, how these ideas would then get re-embedded in a context of another village or another part of the country and kind of have its own specializations. For example, one group is made up of just deaf kids, and it's called the White Glove Orchestra. And the White Glove Orchestra plays with the regular orchestra and is picked up on the rhythm, they can feel the rhythm, and you see these hands moving in perfect unison. I can tell you stories where I've seen 9-year-old kids shot in the leg, and her biggest problem was she was going to be late to the orchestra. And of course, now we know in the United States, one of our most famous conductors in the Los Angeles Philharmonic was one of the first people in this youth orchestra. It was probably one of the world's most famous conductors. So if you see him conduct, you can see him 20 years earlier in the ghetto. So it's those notions of how do you work with the natural occurring forces? How do you do these insertions? We call them systems of action. How do you design something that is meant to kind of start small, grab attention, unfold, adapt, expand? That's kind of a different approach than top-down design.
Let's open up to your, going to open up to your questions. Please give us your name, make it a question, keep it short, and we'll do about 15 minutes of questions, starting with Gus Hauser, who needs no introduction.
But he has a microphone.
What is your outlook for the huge effort being made now in online learning, massive online learning courses, MOOCs?
Well, it probably is not a total surprise that I'm a great fan of the MOOC, because most of the learning I have to do, I'm not going to go back to school. And so you might think about MOOCs as how those of us who are already out of school can easily keep our learning at the cutting edge. And so that's one way to look at it. The the second is it actually does allow flipped instruction, so that basically you can have a great lecture and then you can go into a classroom even this size and actually play with the problem sets. You can almost have more of a studio-based form of learning in terms of you try out the problems now, but you do that socially through peer-based learning with mentorship. So, I mean, I think we're going to see it's transforming what you see at the universities, but I think it's going to be very rich.
So, Sean, over here.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Sean Kelly. I'm interested in your thoughts about creative thinking techniques and tools in general, whether you think universities and institutions can put more emphasis on teaching how to think creatively, and in particular, whether you think that workplaces can tap into the resources of various workers who already have developed ways of solving problems and to allow them to share that so everyone can benefit.
So, let me hold that question a second. There's one thing I wanted to say more here, then I'll come back to your question. A second reason why I'm very excited about MOOCs is for the first time, we may be able to collect enough data to build a serious theory of learning. If I can watch what somebody is doing, if I can watch a million students do something with the techniques we have today, we're going to learn a hell of a lot more about learning. So I think it's going to be a platform to accelerate learning. The back to your question, you know, I have a little bit of a bugaroo. I tend to want to look at imagination, not creativity, because I think it's a real question that if you can't imagine, then it doesn't matter. And if all I'm using is creative methods to do yesterday's problems, but can't imagine new worlds. And so I think we've gotten the bad languaging. I think that, you know, the real coupling of creativity with imagination, and we're not putting enough emphasis on imagination. By the way, if you start thinking about imagination, you go back to reading. You go back to thinking about stories. Harry Potter is an amazing exercising imagination. Okay. So I think we're going to see more of understanding that we have to go beyond what might be called simple crowdsourcing to actually understanding how real design studios work and how, you know, coming together in a studio, your kind of innate sensibilities get pulled to the surface, how instincts really start to matter and things like this. So I think we're going to see kind of bringing that more to the fore, coupled with creativity but imagination. I think we're going to see a big set of changes here. And I think that most of us in the workplace are beginning to realize that there's a hell of a lot of great ideas in the workplace. And with the real question of how do we filter those, which again, peer-based stuff can actually be good at doing. But the reason why I come back to imagination is I think our game today has much more to do with reframing than framing.
I have a question over here in the back.
Hello, my name is Larita Watson, and I'm interested in building learning communities, in particular on Attleboro's here in New York City, the Bronx in particular, Tech Shop, and those learning communities using MOOC and resources such as informal learning communities. Not so we have enough universities. It seem to be universities all around us, yet the majority of people obviously don't have access to them, tuition or whatever, and or like you stated, the new technology or the new learning isn't in the universities.
Right.
So that's the big issue for me. How do we go about doing this? Using the libraries, I in particular, I'm interested in Tech Shop. I think there's one in Detroit, one in their home office in Palo Alto, and the rest. So how do we go about doing that?
Oh, okay. Good question.
Well, I mean, you know, I think you may be asking a question of scale. I mean, like, basically, the maker movements are starting to catch on. They're starting to kind of build their own networks of self-support. As you know, Tech Shop has now been franchised, so anybody can now build their own Tech Shop, more or less. Right. So, but I think there's a second part of what you're getting at. It's conceivable to me that the most important age of learning is seriously between, you know, 2 and 7 or 8. And it's probably prior to 2, but I don't know how to think about that. But I mean, I think that some of these make spaces are going to transform how kids get out of their home, come together. And it's why I came back to things like, the Montessori school method, because there, you know, you start to understand head and hand as a fundamental unit. And that's what I think we have to get back to understanding. And that's true of music playing, of course, et cetera.
We have a question down here. Your name, please.
And then Mary. And numerous times you've mentioned the importance of books and librarians and librarians. And are you aware that New York City is in the process of losing all our major libraries? The Donnell went down, then they plan to tear down the Mid-Manhattan and the Sybil Library and gut the 42nd Street Library. And
well, you'll have a chance to learn about that from Tony Marks tomorrow.
I'm meeting Tony tomorrow morning.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's some kind of secret decision has been made, yeah. And now there is, people fighting against it. But yeah. I just think I agree with you how important libraries are and librarians. And good. I mean, it's different from having a computer at home and having somebody guide you and having
100% different.
Yeah.
It's good. A special space.
Good. We'll give Rita. You have a question right here.
You say everything is premised on sharing. Why do we have any secrets?
Is that the Is that the lead into Jonathan's final question?
I do have a final question. We'll take one more from the audience. Secrets.
I mean, you know, first of all, there is a, you know, I'm not attacking the intellectual property regime. There's a whole question of, well, because if you just spent, you know, 16 years building certain kinds of things, you have to figure out some way to compensate for that. Well, when that gets installed, right? But I mean, I think that my real point is that we get a hell of a lot more out of sharing things than we realize. And in the head world, bringing making back in, et cetera, it's going to make sharing a lot more fun, a lot more exciting, and I think more provocative.
Take a question over here.
I'm finessing your question.
Yeah.
No, I know.
Well, he knows how to do that.
My name is Mike Capek. I was struck by the importance you attach to the act or the concept of listening. And it's probably fair to say that human beings or the human race, human species, advances or evolves only as fast as our language evolves. And nature having given us something to alter the cultural momentum we find ourselves in, namely language.
Right.
Among the four language skills of reading, writing, speaking, and listening, can you say a little bit more about the importance of listening as you look toward the future? Different ways of listening, different values associated with that, the role it'll play in business, in the generation of new and interesting things.
I'll say, you know, just a couple of things. I mean, you know, as you, I think, probably know as well as I do, you listen as much to what's not being said as what is being said. The absence of things tells you often as much as what, you know, than the presence of things. And so you have to kind of listen for the holes as well. They often tell you a lot. And that's, I don't mean just in the intelligence community, where that's obviously true, but I mean in terms, but I think the catch is we tend to get born, we build a frame, and we understand things within that frame. I'm arguing that these frames are being shaken up often. And the real question is, how do you start to listen differently to things that may seem at odds? I mean, for example, you know, running Xerox PARC, as Roger also knows here, you know, it's a fantastic collection of weird people with fantastical ideas, okay? You know, I had to learn myself to listen to an idea that got me pissed off. And, you know, I'd feel getting tense, and I'd have to say, you know, that's a signal. And then I'd have to go back and think about what that signal was really about. Because almost always it was not what I thought it was about. It also is the case in the corporate world, when anybody calls me in to tell me about a real problem, I will guarantee you that's not their problem. Okay? And so you have to listen through that problem to start to explore. And the reason why I come back to this moderately profound but potentially controversial book called Homo Ludens, arguing that, in fact, culture emerges from and through play, not through cognition. A fairly radical hypothesis. Now, this is playing in terms of even things like whack-a-mole. You got to look at what's stable. And then once you find out what's stable, you push the boundaries of that. What's the kind of play in a steering wheel? What's the play in the system? And on and on and on. And so I think once you get used to probe and push, you're then much more willing to say, you know, maybe I should listen more carefully to kind of how a question is not being answered, sorry.
Okay. Et cetera, et cetera.
Yeah, the silence tells you a lot, doesn't it?
Yes.
I'm going to ask the last question, and then those of you who still have questions can come up after, and I'm sure John will stay on. Our mutual friend, Sarah Lawrence Lightfoot, who's been here, has written a book entitled The Third Chapter, about life into the 70s, and then another called Exit. So we'd like to hear about your third and maybe fourth chapters. How is it to step away from a big job like head of Xerox PARC? What has been liberating and what's been hard about the stage of life?
So my answer is a bit bizarre. I now find, and I just got asked this in Aspen 3 days ago, how much do I typically work? And I say I tend to work 70 to 80 hours a week. And this isn't even in Aspen. You know, and the guy, you know, found that unbelievable. And I said, no, you don't understand. I can play golf. I can't really, but I could pretend to, .. But what you don't understand is when you don't have a boss, then work can be arbitrarily fun. And so there's a kind of a sense of saying, like, I don't do anything I really don't want to do, and therefore I can work all the time, and I call it play. And I'm sure, you know, Roger, you find, I think you'd be surprised how many of us find that as long as you're not having to satisfy some person up here for some bureaucratic reason, you know, that you're free to explore. And so in some sense, you know, the world today has unlimited adventure possible. And I have to say that, you know, yeah, if I was a young kid, I could sit in the council of 70, 90, you know, almost as big as me. You know, it was really exciting, the keyboards, the rocker keyboards, by the way. Now, you know, it's amazing how I can touch any part of the world, pull things, find people to interact with, to play with, and then turns out, look around, and there are other people doing that. So, I mean, this is an amazing time.
And something you'd like to do that you haven't done, that you want to do before while you're able?
I don't want to go back to the motorcycle discussion. But maybe.
Well, you've given us a fascinating hour and a half of conversation, and I do recommend The Power of Pull. John, I want to thank you for a terrific evening. Thanks all very much for coming.